Welcome back. Originally, it was made by monks and used for medical purposes, considered to be a cure for smallpox. Today, the global whiskey industry is worth approximately £100 billion, with the rarest bottles of malt selling for almost £2 million at auction. Some say that whiskey was invented in Ireland in 1757. But as we all know, it was taken up with enthusiasm by the Scots. And today, exports of whiskey from the United Kingdom amount to more than £8 billion a year. But where I am now, there are no Munros and no Glens. This is flat as a pancake Norfolk, where the spirit has brought me. Today we're talking about English whiskey at the English Distillery and the English Whiskey Company. I imagine this cannot be a very old distillery because I don't associate England with whiskey.
We started in 2005. My father had a dream, having been a farmer all his life, to turn barley into something more useful, as he put it. And finally, on his 60th birthday, he was like, I really am going to open a distillery. And it was never going to be on this scale. It was going to be a smaller, a bit like sort of the microbreweries that were opening. But luckily, our HMRC, so you can't open a small distillery back then. So we built this one. And yeah, England's first registered whiskey distillery. And here we are, 16, 17 years later.
Had your family been on the land for a while?
So we are 600 years, pretty much straight line going back. And still today, the vast majority of Nelstrops are either part of the eastern side of the country farming, or there's a grain mill operating near Manchester, still one of the largest in the country, which is the other half of the family.
So you have barley, obviously. Do you have water as well?
So this area of Norfolk is called the Breckland, and it sits over the Breckland aquifer, which is a fantastic source of cold, which is very important, pure water. So we've got it, grain grown in East Anglia, and water, don't need anything else. So the distilling floor itself is where the barley is turned into alcohol. We start off by milling the grain, and that grain each morning is mixed with hot water into the mash tun. And what you end up with is like sloppy porridge. It goes into the fermenters where we add a bit of yeast. Quite quickly, over the course of 24 hours, it will turn all that sugary liquid into an alcoholic beer, basically. What we're left with after 5 days is a very flavoursome real ale, I suppose, that is then taken to the first of the pair of stills. And the wash still takes that 5,000 litres of beer and it reduces it down to a clearish spirit of around 20% alcohol. So we take that white spirit and we put it in the second still, the spirit still. Once it starts distilling, we take a section in the middle, known as the cut or the heart of the whiskey. And that section in the middle becomes maturing whiskey. By law, whiskey has to go into oak, or rather a wooden cask, traditionally oak, for at least 3 years.
This, I believe, is called the bonded warehouse, and we're surrounded by barrels. Tell me a little bit about them.
Most of our casks are what we call ASB, or American Standard Barrels. The reason they are used all over the industry is in order to make bourbon, by law, you've got to put it into a virgin cask, one that's never been used before. And bourbon doesn't take long to mature, quite often 2 to 4 years. So the moment they empty a cask, they can't reuse it. Huh. So the vast majority of whiskey is matured in ex-bourbon casks. They're brilliant because they're very consistent in size. They give a very consistent flavour, which is what you want when you're creating product that may take 50 years to do again. In Scotland, what happens in the cask is during the heat of the day, the liquid expands and it pushes the alcohol vapour out through the oak. And at night it cools down and sucks in fresh air again. But it's not very warm in Scotland, as we all know, and so they lose about 2% a year through evaporation. It's called the angel's share. Here in Norfolk, where the sun always shines and it's an awful lot warmer, apart from today where it's freezing, our angel's share is actually about 5%, which is huge. The downside is, of course, we're losing more alcohol. The upside is we're maturing an awful lot faster.
And you have very happy Norfolk Angels.
We have very happy Norfolk Angels.
Imbibing all of that. And so this is an example of transatlantic recycling.
Exactly that, yes.
And I have a feeling we can taste some whiskey somewhere a bit warmer.
We definitely can.
Let's do that.
Andrew, I think of this as being quite a small distillery, but what a range of products. How do you decide what to produce?
Ultimately, we only produce two things. We produce a peated spirit and an unpeated. But then once it goes into casks, the world's your oyster. There are loads of different casks, as we discussed, and each one creates something different. And, of course, time as well. An 8-year-old tastes different to a 10-year-old. So
a distillery like this has to be very clear about what its market is. You're going for a niche, aren't you?
I think you start off as a niche because that's all you can do to start with. With whiskey, there are only a few bottles you made on day one, and therefore it is quite niche. You start off only for the whiskey enthusiasts, if you like. We go to whiskey shows, and you meet, they don't mind, whiskey anoraks. And that is the marketplace you start off with.
I don't own an anorak, but do I qualify for a tasting?
You definitely are having a tasting. Well, these are our two core products. We've got our original, which is what it says, unpeated, and then we've got a smoky one. So we'll try the original first. So that's definitely our best seller. When my father first started, it was very clear in the business plan he did not want to make weird and wacky left field whiskey. He just wanted a really good single malt that he could share with mates. It's just a really lovely, easy drinking single malt.
Mmm. Oh. It's incredibly soft and smooth.
It is very easy drinking.
It rolls around the tongue beautifully, doesn't it? Yeah. What a lovely whiskey. Tell me about peat. I think I'm going to like it even more with peat.
Fine.
But where does the peat suddenly arrive from?
When we ring our maltster, we order peated or plain malt. But they still do it the same way, and they're still burning a traditional peat fire, and that smoke goes through the barley, and it stays in the barley until it gets to us, and it then stays in the liquid all the way through the process. We have deliberately picked peats that give us more of a bonfire smoke, so it's smoke rather than peat, which I think is more approachable to a lot of people. So this is our smoky English whiskey. We'll have a taste.
For Pete's sake, that is delicious. That's the one for me.
There you are. And what is extraordinary is both of those products, both of those single malt whiskies, are made in the same way, matured in the same casks, and are the same age. And the only difference is the malting process and a bit of that peat smoke being blown over the barley. And they're completely different, aren't they?
Can English whiskey be as good as Scotch?
Easily, yes. No reason it shouldn't. We are a distillery. Ultimately, it's just a series of equipment and skill sets. And we all use malted barley, and we all use water.
So nothing about Scottish water, nothing about the cold weather in Scotland, none of those things gives them an advantage over you?
No. All it does is mean that their whiskey is unique to them, and our whiskey is unique to us. But we can all do the job very well. And just like you can make whiskey in Sweden and France and Japan and Australia, there's no reason we shouldn't be able to make it in England, Wales and Scotland.
A vote for santé.
Cheers.
Thanks to Andrew Nelstrop and everyone at the English Distillery Company.